Welcome to the Creative Community Podcast, presented by Destination Arete. I'm David.
And I'm Mark, and we're building a community of creatives who work together to achieve creative excellence. Today's guest is our good friend, Nathan Drushinin. Nathan is an art instructor and a fine artist.
And he joins us today to talk about his passion, art supplies. And more specifically, we asked Nathan to share his recent research into fine art paintbrushes. So without further ado, let's go to that conversation. Welcome back to the show. And Mark said, and you and I talked a little bit about it last week, but you've been, just let us know what you've been researching lately in the art supply world. We know art supply is your thing that you love. So I just wanted to find out from you, like, what's your latest passion or what's your latest project?
Yeah, well, thank you guys again for having me on. It's always good to see you and talk to you guys, two of my favorite people. Always a good time. But yeah, I've been spending just hundreds and hundreds of dollars buying new brushes and testing all kinds of different brushes. It's really fun because Mark and I get to work together in a painting class this semester. He's helping me out with basic painting two, which is very medium heavy as far as just switching mediums. Every project is a new medium.
And
so yeah, each medium, it's a lot of fun. The students get a little bit stressed out with that. Like, I like doing it. I like every year. It's really fun. Even this year with Mark helping out doing acrylic demos and things like that, I actually learned from what Mark had learned. So that was really fun. And each medium, I'd say brushes are important, especially watercolor and oil. Those to me seem to be the most important. And maybe acrylic or gouache painters out there would you know, throw their hat in the ring there. And the brushes do make a difference with those mediums as well, but I usually find I can get away with just the, you know, cheapo $5 set of 20 brushes from Hobby Lobby with those. And yeah, the oil and the watercolor, I really like to try to have, you know, a really fine tool to apply the paint with. And I find that helps and it actually makes the experience a lot more fun.
I need to try acrylic then, because I have the cheap Hobby Lobby and I've tried oil and it's just a, well, we'll get to that. I think we're going to get to that in a minute, but
sure.
Yeah,
I need to try acrylic.
Yeah. Acrylic. I think David, you would really like acrylic. And so maybe this summer we'll hit up some acrylic and yeah. So be looking on the Instagram this summer. Maybe we'll post some of David's acrylic paintings. That could be fun. he's saying, no, don't do it. For those of you who aren't watching on YouTube, he's going, don't do it. Mr. Drew, I wanted to ask you, because I know we've been having a lot of conversations, like you said, in the classroom about different brushes. And I wanted to ask you about what you've discovered about using different kinds of brushes at different stages of the painting, because that was super interesting to me. And I'd love our audience to be able to kind of hear that. Those ideas.
Yeah. So it all started back in 1998 when I started. Oh, and just a heads up, if I start to sink out of frame, it's because of my office chair. Like the plunger just gives way every once in a while.
I've owned one of those before.
Yeah. I mean, I got me money. I got my refund. I could afford a new one. I'm just, I don't know. Anyways,
too busy buying brushes, right?
Yeah,
you got to prioritize. yeah, you can stand and paint, you know, so. yeah, so it started when I was a sophomore, just taking my first oil painting class. And the teachers, you know, we had the brushes in the bookstore. They were like really student grade, not the best hog hair bristle brushes. That's kind of what I used for a long time. And then talking to Brian Jekyll, one of my teachers and mentors, finding out about some better quality brushes, and that made a big difference. And I don't know, I kind of set it to the side for a while. And just within the last year or so, I go on different kicks, you know, like mountain biking kick, pocket knife collecting kick, you know, all kinds of different, you know, little side trails and things like that. But I've just kind of been wanting to explore more about the brushes. I've been hearing especially a lot about the Rosemary Brush Company for years and never really, you know, bit the bullet to buy some of them. Honestly, they're not that expensive compared to other brushes.
Right.
I guess maybe what kind of set me back from wanting to buy them is because they're in England and I didn't want to have to wait, you know, weeks and weeks for brushes. But there are companies in the US who are distributors. And so in 2 or 3 days, I can get brushes instead of having to wait weeks. So within the last year, you know, wanting to explore that more, and probably a big part, just hearing Mark talk about his experience with Daniel Keyes and the brushes that he likes to use. And the brush does not make the artist, but it makes the artist's job easier. Mm-hmm. There's, you were talking, David, last week about how in the comment section of every video, people are always asking, what type of brushes are you using? And some artists will kind of make jokes about that. It's like,
oh, what colors are your brush handles?
You know, things that don't really matter, but the actual make of the brush, the quality of the brush, the hairs that are used make a big difference. So hearkening back to my early painting days, just sticking with the bristle brushes, and most of the audience probably knows what a bristle brush is, but it's actual hog hair bristle. Okay. So that's a natural hair brush. And for oil paint, there's something special about a natural hog hair bristle, and I don't want to offend, you know, our vegan friends or anything like that, but the hog hairs, they have flag tips. So each hair has like two other hairs, you know, cut one hair off and two shall take it place, take its place.
Okay.
So wow. At the end, yeah, there is a different feel to a natural hair bristle as opposed to synthetic hair brushes. And you can still paint with just synthetic brushes, but I really like the way the bristle brush holds the paint and, you know, kind of piles it on in those first stages. Mark, your question. I apologize ahead of time. Mark knows I just go on way too many rabbit trails. So I'm trying to answer the question. So I like starting, talking to Mark's question was,
yeah,
different brushes for different stages in the painting. I really like using the bristle brushes for the beginning painting and probably the majority of the painting. And then I find as you start layering the paint, and this gets into surface and canvas and things too, which is maybe another conversation for another day, but getting that base layer paint on. And then I find it's very personal too. So I don't want anybody out there to think that this is dogmatic, like this is the way you have to paint. It's, you know, people do incredible things. I think even the last interview I talked about Franz Hals, where they said he could chew on a stick and paint with that, you know.
Right.
Some people can get away with really subpar equipment and still make beautiful things. Nikolai Blokhin is another one. He's a Russian artist. And I can't remember if I mentioned him last time or not, but he does some beautiful paintings over there in Russia. And I got to watch him, he came over to the States for an exhibition and he was doing a demonstration and he had maybe 4 or 5 brushes. None of them mm-hmm. seemed really particularly exceptional. And most of the painting, he was just smushing his paint around with his fingers. Yeah, and it wasn't abstract. It was a very nice representational portrait. It was beautiful. And one of the audience members said, I noticed you use your fingers a lot. And he, in his, you know, strong Russian accent said, he's best brush. And I just love that story.
That's
so
amazing.
Yeah. So that's kind of just, you know, a little precursor here. I'm not saying you have to spend hundreds of dollars on brushes. You can do beautiful things with just the brushes God gave you on your hands. But for me, in my beginning stages and blocking in, I really like the bristle brush, especially if my canvas is a little more coarse or absorbent. If I start with a very soft brush, I get frustrated because especially canvas, you know, it's got, it's woven like fabric. And with a very soft brush, it's like you're wrestling to get that paint to fill in the canvas, which maybe you don't want, but I like to cover the canvas. It frustrates me when like the white speckles of the priming still show through in my painting. So I find the bristle brushes, they're kind of the powerhouse and they have a firmer bristle and are able to apply that paint, fill in the canvas. And then once you have that base coat of paint on there, if I keep using the bristle to apply more paint, sometimes it tends to lift more than it will apply. And that is also handling of the brush. If you, you know, if you just stab and drag with the brush, of course that's going to lift paint off. If you, you know, gingerly hold it and then just get the brush more parallel with the surface and drag it down, that will leave more paint. But I've been finding that the softer hair brushes then seem to work a little bit better for that next layer of paint. And so then I got into some, these are a Princeton brush, the Aspen line, which is a really, really nice synthetic brush. It holds a sharper chisel edge. That's what I find is one of the benefits of moving to the synthetic brushes, is it just holds this razor sharp edge.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, you can get really crisp little details and lines, and it is it's stiff, but it's a little bit softer than that natural bristle brush. So I find it's a little easier to lay that second layer of paint on. And then we get into the rosemaries, which their synthetics, I am super happy with. They're amazing. They're natural bristles. So I don't want to like down talk anything, you know, but sometimes, I'm not sponsored. Are you guys sponsored?
No, not yet.
Okay. We're trying to be sponsored.
Okay, well, this might ruin your chances. But so I
desire honesty, Mr. Drew. Please give us honesty.
Okay, yeah. And I don't want to go either of two extremes. I don't want to say, I don't want to be like just swept in with brand and say, because it's rosemary, it's the best. It's the emperor's new clothes, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't want to go to the other extreme and say, you know, just be counterculture because everybody uses rosemary. Well, then I don't like rosemary. But I tried every single one of their different lines of natural hair bristles. They're not bad. They're definitely better than those student grade brushes I started with, but compared to brand, but the Robert Simmons Signet natural hair bristles. So that's a tan colored handle with a green tip, if you're wondering.
That's pretty.
Yeah, the Robert Simmons, the way that they shape the brush and brush making is an art in and of itself. There's awesome videos you can find of like the Winsor Newton Company, where you know, these people that have been making brushes for decades, and their hands, it's just like magic watching them form the brushes. It's much more than just gluing hair onto a stick and then cutting it with scissors. If you find a brush like that, it's probably not that good. The flag tips, remember, they have shaped it so that how they positioned the length of the bristles is, this is a filbert shape, that domed shape rather than just a flat chisel shape brush, but they have chosen the length of the hairs, and so it's creating that natural dome. The rosemary bristles, I found you can tell it looks like they trimmed them. And once again, it's not a bad brush, but it doesn't hold its shape as well as the Robert Simmons, in my experience. And other people might say, no, I prefer the rosemaries to the Robert Simmons natural hair brushes. So that's just the natural hair brushes. The synthetics are the best synthetics I've ever used. So I will say they make a good product, but I'm just not a fan of every product they make.
So this is a really nerdy question, and I apologize, Mark, but so what you're saying is sometimes companies cut the top of the brush after it's been inserted, and other companies cut the bottom of the bristles and then put them in based on the length that they are? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, either cutting the bottom of the bristles, or the Winsor Newton Company, they will actually, because hair, just as it grows, will have different lengths. They will size the different length hairs on their Series 7, which is their Series 7 Kolinsky Sable watercolor brushes, are some of so I have not tried that brush yet. I do geek out about brushes. I have not tried that one yet, but that is supposed to be kind of the epitome of watercolor brushes. So they're actually grading the lengths of the hairs and then combining them and shaping them by size of hair like that.
Someone gets paid to measure hog hair.
Yeah.
They literally split hairs for a living. Hey, come on, Mr. Drew's on. I get to make my puns.
I liked it, Mark. Yes, thank you.
Oh man. Well, here's my question. As was stated at the beginning, I'm not a very accomplished, just a beginning artist, and I only see Bob Ross clean his brush maybe once an episode when I watch him, and I sometimes watch him and I fall asleep because it's so relaxing. Yeah. But if I'm lucky, I see him clean his brush. So when I went out, I plein aired a couple times in 2020, mm-hmm. And it was a thing. And I felt like I needed to be cleaning my brush like every other stroke because, yeah. Number one, I wasn't doing that fancy technique. I was kind of just stabbing. Yeah. But what am I missing? Like, why is he only, is he using like a thousand brushes and he just doesn't show us? Or like, is there certain brushes that hold paint like worse than others because it gets us stuck in there? Or is that too broad of a question?
No, that's a great question. And I think that's also very personal. I don't mean to cop out and just say everything is personal, but yeah, he would clean his brush though. He talks about he's got his big jar of mineral spirits underneath his easel, and he's got that beater bar where you ever hear him.
Yeah, you know, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Ticka, ticka,
yeah,
ticka,
ticka, ticka. Yeah, yeah. He's like,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, cleaning the brush off, getting the mineral spirits out. So he would clean it because of the magic of editing. Maybe they edited out some of the cleaning sections. So can get away with few brushes, and my students are living proof of that. So I kind of on the other extreme with watercolor, I don't need as many brushes. It's a lot easier to clean those in water. But the mineral spirits, if you get too much mineral spirits in your paint, it just makes it run too much. So I've got dozens, if not hundreds, of brushes here. And when I'm painting, if I'm like in the throes of inspiration and I'm, you know, painting away, I'll have two dozen different brushes, all with paint on them. And so I will designate, I'll have these brushes for my light values, these brushes for my mid-tone values, these brushes for my shadow values. And in that, you don't really need to clean them as much if you have brushes for separate values. I think I picked that up from John Howard Sandin's book and some of his videos. He talks about where he's got dozens of brushes, and as he's doing a commissioned portrait, he'll use all of his brushes and won't clean them until he, you know, is done for the day. And he has enough brushes where he can just keep painting without having to stop and clean. Within other artists, you can clean the brushes. So like I said, one of the reasons I don't like to clean brushes while I'm painting is because you'll, no matter how much you wipe the mineral spirits out, you'll still have some of that residue in the bristles, and it's going to get the paint a little more soupy. Something another friend told me is if you are going to clean your brushes while you're painting, he recommends having like a little cup of walnut oil or linseed oil. So you clean your brushes out with the mineral spirits, wipe them out, and then dip them back in the oil and then wipe it out. And then oil kind of primes it and gets it back ready to have that heavier consistency paint without dissolving it too much. So yeah, you can paint with few brushes. You can paint with a lot of brushes. It's, you know, kind of your personal preference. But if you paint with a lot of brushes, then it would be really nice to have a studio assistant to clean them all out. Although I was telling Mark, we went out plein air painting yesterday, and I just got an order of a supply that I was wanting to try in the mail. I was bringing it down with me. And I was trying to open the box when I was at a stoplight, and I sliced my thumb open. I get to the park and I have like a fistful of blood. I'm like, hey guys, you got a paper towel? Anyway, nothing. Yeah, nothing related to this, you know.
What they don't tell you in art school.
Right, yeah. But that's note to self, have a studio assistant that sits in the passenger seat and opens your packages for you.
Yes, so. smart. One of these days. Right. But there is something, there's a guy on YouTube, he has the Draw Mix Paint channel. And he also owns and operates the Geneva Paint Company. And he's made this, which is called his brush dip.
Yeah.
And so this is safflower oil and clove leaf oil, which clove leaf oil, or just clove oil, it really slows down the drying of the paint. So I'm experimenting with it. So he says he does not clean his brushes at all, except for like rare occasions. But that, because the clove leaf oil is going to keep the paint wet for weeks, he says you don't have to clean your brushes. And so you just dip them in a little bit of that, you know, get a jar with that dip, and you just dip them in there. And then when you're ready to go, wipe it out and keep painting. So yeah, there's different ways to go about it. I know Mark was talking about Adam Clegg and putting brushes in the freezer to keep the paint from drying and avoiding having to clean them that often.
So, that's what I do when I'm patching holes in my drywall, but I never thought about it for like a fine art.
What do you do with your drywall?
You wrap it in saran wrap and then you put it in the fridge so that the next day you just pull it out, put your second coat on, and then you don't have to, have to spend 1,000 hours trying to clean all this paint, you know.
That's smart. But
I didn't think about it. And from the fine art perspective, I'm sure that's a viable option.
And some artists that like to work wet into wet on their canvas will actually freeze their paintings overnight as well. Because that way they can just work directly wet into wet. So Mom and I did that. We would freeze our paintings for like, if we were doing a still life over multiple days. It was super, super like helpful. So
Can't sell those paintings at Wendy's.
Right, exactly, because they were frozen. And Wendy's only has never frozen, so that's great. You do have to be careful though what you grab. Like if you're in there late at night looking for a snack, you don't want to grab a brush is not a popsicle, so don't stick it in your mouth. But well, Mr. Drew, we have our final, I guess, our theme or our game where we're gonna do a little bit of like a desert island kind of thing. So here's the scenario: we're headed out to paint on location, and you've got one. Right, we're gonna plein air outdoors. Okay. We've got one 8x10 canvas, your three primary colors in white, a small palette, enough Gamsol to clean out your brushes as much as you want. Now, you get three brushes and three brushes only.
Okay.
So this is like an overnight camping thing. You've got to have room for food and pocket knives. Right. You know, multiple.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
So you can only get three brushes. That's how much room you have. So yeah. We need to know from you what you're bringing.
Which three are you bringing?
Okay, so 8x10, I'd probably go with a number 8 Filbert Robert Simmons Signet, the my favorite bristle brush. I'd probably go with a number 4 square Aspen synthetic brush, or the Rosemary makes the ivory line synthetic brush, which is very comparable to these. So a number 4 square synthetic brush. And then, what Mark had introduced me to was the Rosemary combers, extra long combers. So
those are fun.
Yeah, like you're all asking me about this kind of stuff, but really, I mean, I'm learning a lot from Mark too. So then probably the 1/8 inch Rosemary extra long comber, which this is crazy. 1/8 inch wide, which is not very wide, but when you get paint on it, it gets to like a needle point. And really nice, great for, so talking about layering,
starting
starting with the bristle brushes, moving up to the synthetic brushes, and then to the really soft long haired synthetic brushes. Those, it's such a joy to paint with these, because even if you've got that thick paint on your canvas and you load this up, like Mark has been showing me, you can still apply paint without really disturbing that bottom layer. So this would be great for details or layers. So those would probably be my three. You guys have any input in that?
Well, I was just gonna say, that's super helpful about knowing about the comber, because that's usually people's biggest complaint with oil and when they go outside and plein air paint, is it's all running together. I remember talking to a new student and they were like, I want to be able to cover up the mistake that I just put down. And so, but since it's not acrylic, since it's not drawing, they can't just put it over. And so having something, first of all, scraping off, the mistake you made, but then having something like that comber that can just layer it right on top. Oh, it's so helpful. So, So thank you for participating with the first pick in the brush draft. Mr. Drushinin takes the Robert Simmons,
That's great.
Oh yeah.
Do you have anything different you would choose, or
me?
Yeah.
Oh, so I would do, my trusted tool right now is the Rosemary Ivory flat. So the one that Mr. Drew took second, I would probably take first. Just a difference. Cause I follow an artist named Joshua Bean, and Joshua Bean is a much more, Mr. Drew paints a little bit more naturalistically, I guess. Like he has more gradated forms and things. Whereas Joshua Bean would paint more blocky, like everything is blocky. And so I'm trying to work on personally, like simplifying my shapes, just because I'm still learning in that process of like how to design my shape. So I've switched over to trying to do, because I started out using some sort of bristle brush that I should not have been using, because I couldn't get it, because I was using it in the wrong stage, like Mr. Drew was talking about, it would just lift the paint off the canvas and I was poking it instead of laying it horizontally. So I would say the only change I would make is I would probably just take the flat first, and then I would in my draft, just so that to make sure that I had it in my arsenal.
Yeah. Nice. So,
yeah. And then I have a little rosemary synthetic, or no, I don't know if it's a synthetic, but it was a filbert, but it's turned into a spear point, and it's what I use to draw with. It's literally the shape is turned into this little spear point, but I love it for drawing, and I, poor thing, I've ruined it, but I'll take that one too.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I've gotten to see it. It's awesome. Are you in your apartment, Mark? Are you at the studio?
I'm at the studio, but the studio's down the hall.
So oh, okay.
I would go get mine and show them, but I should have brought them.
Yeah.
Well, I was watching an Andrew Tischler video, and he was talking about, for those who don't know, if you don't know who Andrew Tischler is, he's got hundreds of videos on art supplies, but he was talking about how he actually shapes the brushes to what he wants them to be. But I think from what you said about the hair, I'm thinking now that he was talking about brushes that were synthetic and not the, because he was like, it sounds a little silly to cut these, but it's not changing the shape of the fibers themselves. Cause I was kind of like listening to it out of the corner of my eye, like type of thing. So I'll need to go back and look and see, but that was just interesting to me what Mark said about it. It's changed its shape after being used. So sometimes I guess using it can change its shape, or you can force it to be a shape that you need when you're out and about, or when you're in your studio. So that was an interesting thing that I hadn't thought about.
Right. Yeah. And that is really interesting. Like I remember Russell Case told a story about, because different people prefer different levels of use of brushes. Some people feel like they have to break them in, and other people feel like they like them new, you know, fresh. They're always getting new brushes. And Russell Case said that he had all these brushes that they were old and all crusty, you know, and so he had thrown them out on a painting trip. And his friend, Len Schmiel, who was his mentor, he walked up to the group and he goes, "Guys, guess what I just found in the trash? Someone threw away all these really great brushes." And Russ goes, "Those were mine, Len." And he goes, "Why'd you throw them away? They're just now good." He said, "I have to work years to get my brushes to be this good." So he took them and he said he did a painting on that trip that won an award with Russ's brushes. And so Russ said he was so mad because he was like, "Man, I should have held on to those things. Maybe they would have been worth something."
That's amazing. What a great story. Wow. Yeah.
It sounds like somebody in their frames from a frame shop. Somebody.
Yeah. Finding gold in the dumpster.
I didn't even remember what I talked about.
as seen on a previous episode. You know?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Previously on the Destination Arte podcast.
Mr. Flashback. Drew.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Well, hey, Mr. Drew, before we let you go, quick bonus question. You're still on that camping trip with the paintings and the paintbrushes. What pocket knife have you brought?
Oh, boy.
Oh, it's on him right now.
Actually, he knows.
In his pocket.
It would honestly probably be, I would prefer a fixed blade.
Okay.
For survival, like instances. So probably my Bark River, Fox River EXT2, which is, we could have another Destination Arete chat on blade steels and things like that, but just the grind, the shape, the length, the durability, that's probably what I'd pick. But for kicks, I just got this one. It's it's a folding pocket kukri from Cold Steel. I don't know, should I be showing this on here?
We'll blur it out for the sensitive viewers.
Yeah. So
there's just a bar that comes up and it just says rosemary brush here. Yeah.
But like a pocket machete. So you can like hack your way through the woods and stuff. And
nice.
Pretty fun. And it's, People sometimes freak out about knives, but it's the oldest tool, you know, really, if you think about it. So
yeah,
we're still carrying on the tradition of our forefathers. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's great with oil painting. You get to play with brushes and knives because yes, of the palette knife aspect. So two of your favorite things combined.
I've sliced my thumb on a palette knife before too. So, you know,
you should make a blood pact with your two thumbs, you know, one amazing. From the painting knife, one from the regular knife.
Yeah. I think you should just be more careful.
That's yeah, I was telling one of my students yesterday after she saw my thumb was all bandaged up. I told her the story and I said, yeah, don't play with knives in cars. And she's like, how about just don't play with knives ever? Yeah, that's maybe. Great advice. Yeah.
Once again, we are so grateful to Nathan for joining us on the podcast this week. For more from Mr. Drew, you can listen to episode 82 of the Creative Community Podcast, where we talk to him there. And you should really go follow him on Instagram at Nathan Drushinin or on his YouTube channel, Mr. Drew Paints With You, where you will find amazing art tutorials and instructional videos.
As always, subscribe to us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, and SoundCloud for more episodes like this one. And leave us a comment or a review on Apple Podcasts if you liked this episode or if you have a favorite part of what we had to talk about with Nathan. And then feel free to share with a friend who might benefit from the information that Mr. Drew shared with us today.
You can also connect with us on Facebook and Instagram at Destination Arete, A-R-E-T-E, for more interviews like this one, as well as information about community activities and upcoming Arete projects. We'll be back in 2 weeks with another interview, and we cannot wait to see you then.